Welcome here. Thank you for tuning in again. We're going to try to keep this up as a weekly show, not throughout the Christmas break. We'll hopefully have one more as a little surprise Christmas special with Chloe and myself.
I'm Daniel McIntyre. Very excited for our Christmas special. WRTV, I personally felt like if we were going to have a televised program, we needed to have a Christmas special. It was just a necessity at this point.
There might be some interesting locations too, but I'll leave that for next week. You'll have to tune in to check that out. So, but going back to this week, as you may have noticed, we have more people than usual. Usually we have four people. We got five, if you can count the five. Today, Chloe and I are joined by Heather Unger, Jamie Hamilton, and Quinn Snyder. Jamie, Quinn, and I have all been part of a class where at CMU this semester called Participatory Local Development, taught by the great Kenton Lobey. One of the main themes as a class we were either introduced to or maybe reintroduced to were ideas of kind of alternative ways of education. And if that sounds cool to you, we kind of touched on that in our previous episode with Kenton and then David Balzer, me and Chloe. So go check that out if that sounds interesting. But kind of in direct relation to in CMU and alternative ways of education in this class, we looked at the land-based learning proposal that Kenton has kind of had his hands in for the past little while. And that's where this episode comes in. So maybe by way of introduction, how about the three of you say a little bit about yourself and your kind of involvement, knowledge levels with this whole land-based learning proposal? Maybe we can start with Jamie.
Yeah, for sure. Well, first, it's nice to be here with you guys. So I've been in the realm of this land-based learning for 2 years now. I was in a class last semester with Kenton where we worked with the permaculture design with Heather. So I'm pretty familiar with this all, I would say. Not a master of it by any means, but I've done some research with it. And I'm just looking forward to what this means for CMU, I guess, with land-based learning.
Awesome. Yeah. And how about you, Quinn?
So unlike Jamie, I'm a little newer to this. I'm actually a business student. So this whole land-based learning permaculture idea is quite fresh, quite new to me. I've only taken one other IDS course, and that was with Ray last year, Project Cycle. And obviously this is my first Kenton class, first kind of exposure to the land-based learning. But as over the course of the semester, it's been really interesting and I've been able to, kind of gain a bit more, knowledge and get my foot in the door as to, what all is going on, at CMU, outside of, you know, the Redicop School of Business and, you know, that's small over on north side there.
And then we have our resident expert Heather. How about you tell us a little bit about your involvement with this and the permaculture plan.
Sure so I guess it started a year or two ago when I approached Kenton with both the offer of some trees for the campus that my family, my husband and kids and I have been propagating, but also with information about a permaculture design course that I was taking at the time. And so of course that kind of snowballed into what we have now, which was a class involved with collecting data for my site design for CMU. And now of course further conversation around what, how if it could be implemented on campus. So I'm really happy to be here.
Yeah.
Awesome.
We're very happy to have you here.
And hi, I'm Chloe. I have no idea what's going on. I know that we have land. I know that we know how to learn. And I'm excited to realize the ways that it can be put together.
Yeah, so I guess to start things off, maybe let's talk a bit about the composting project that's been going on this past year this past semester at CMU, because that's been something that's kind of been pushed, at least in my eyes, that's been kind of pushed by students and kind of alumni of CMU to make work. And basically, It's a massive composting program that's set up outside of the CMU farm, Metanoia Farmers, and it's kind of come to fruition this year, and it has a part in this whole land-based learning project. Would anybody be willing to kind of speak about their experiences with that? Because I know that Jamie, Quinn, and I all kind of helped build it as part of the class. I guess we'd all kind of worked on
how do you build a composting station?
Good question. I mean, we were part of the people that actually moved some of the compost, actual physical compost, from the farm over to the new bins. Was that kind of your first experience kind of working with kind of compost, Quinn, Jamie? It's kind of a weird question, but
yes and no to that scale. Yes. Growing up in my backyard, we had a small little composter. I don't know if my parents bought it at Canadian Tire or something, where you just kind of throw your apple cores, your banana peels and whatnot, and your eggshells or whatever into that composter, and let it do its thing. Like Dan said, that's, we kind of got our hands on it, during one of our classes. We just kind of came to class and Kenton said, you know what, we're going out back and we're going to help, Justin move all the compost from the old, station to the new, which, you know, by far looked, from a carpentry standpoint, looked much more sound and effective. Lots more volume of compost can actually be held in those new bins. And I think there's a lot more opportunity and a lot more compost that can effectively come out of those bins and be moved and used in the soil back towards the CMU farm and the Metanoia farm as well.
Yeah. Well, one of the things that it kind of is helping out is that all of the food waste from the calf goes into it. And I think everybody else is welcome to bring it in, bring their own compost in and use it there. It's a massive setup. But one of the really cool things that Justin Azinga, who you mentioned, Quinn, built recently to help transport the compost is this wacky bike that will actually fully transport the compost from location to location and throw it in. And I think he finished it recently. It's unfortunate he's not able to be here, but I would have loved to hear him talk about that bike. So it's got this kind of connection into the farm, into Folio, into the calf. A lot of people might not know its connection to the land-based learning. Jamie, would you talk a little bit about the connection that it has to the land-based learning proposal?
Yeah, so as far as I know, like you said, Dan, the composting project is for the larger group of CMU and the farms that are included with it. So a lot of it is just around food security here at CMU. So Heather's, her permaculture design project kind of touched on it a lot there, where CMU has the opportunity to just close its food security circle and kind of maintain it within a campus. So through the compost, you can reuse that on the farm and vice versa. So just kind of creating a lot more closer food network at CMU. I guess that would be kind of all that I've learned.
Heather, yeah, I have a question. Oh, yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
No, go for it.
I've been hearing the term permaculture design thrown around a lot. Can you explain to me as a newbie what that means?
For sure. So permaculture was a term that was coined in the 1970s by a couple of guys in Australia who drew to at least some degree on indigenous ways of land methods in land use and so on. The purpose being to create a permanent kind of agriculture, permaculture, that does two things. First of all, that rebuilds, recreates, regenerates ecosystems for the benefit of the earth. And then secondly, increases capacity for food security. So, and of course, we know that so often those things are seen as being in conflict with each other, that our draw on the earth for our own needs necessarily has to be a negative impact on the earth. And permaculture challenges that notion and says, well, no, we can actually be a positive presence on earth. We don't have to simply minimize erosion. We can build soil. We don't have to just be a drawdown. We can be a facilitator of ecological health, I guess, and regeneration. So,
awesome. Thank you. That's a, yeah, that's a great explanation. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so then when Jamie was talking about the food security part to land-based learning proposal and your permaculture design, was that something that was originally in your thoughts when you were starting the report?
Sorry, say again?
Was the idea of this food security, this importance of food security, was this one of the things that was one of the major players in your thinking at the start of this whole project?
Initially, it had been a small part, but interestingly, right at the tail end of my design process, COVID blew up. The thing that prompted my design work was the climate crisis, right? The UN comes out with this report that says, we're in crisis, right? And of course, it's a crisis that we can't necessarily see in terms of immediate impact, but there's this kind of red flag every, you know, there's this global cry for change. And so that's what prompted me to look for hopeful avenues to act and not just talk in circles, right? It was a source of great frustration for me to see politicians just talking about the climate crisis without, in my mind, showing any kind of commitment or any kind of action. But then toward the tail end of my design process, COVID really heightened the issue of food security. And because we saw our food distribution systems really being strained, you know, on one hand, people are at food banks. On the other hand, 10 million chickens are getting slaughtered because there's no way to get them to market. So this really strained breakdown in our food distribution systems, which raised anxiety around food supply locally. I saw the opportunity for that issue to be addressed in this, in the plan, to say, okay, well, maybe there are ways that we can bring food production back home again, instead of sourcing it out as we've been doing in the last number of decades. So.
Awesome. Yeah. So then I guess kind of straying away from the idea straight on of food security, but what in a few short words, maybe I'll get it from all four of us that are familiar with this. What does, if the land-based learning proposal were to be implemented in you, what would that look like for CMU? And maybe not just to paraphrase the document, but maybe a few small bullet points. Any takers? I can go for it. I guess one of the things that for me is kind of most exciting about this is this kind of closed loop of food in general and waste between folio, between the calf and the farm. Also potentially the engulfment, that's the wrong word, but it's got the same idea, of the farm into CMU, to become part of CMU and not a separate entity. Those are some things that I think would be super interesting.
Yeah, to just like build off your point there, Dan, I think what I'm excited for is the potential it has for CMU to kind of grow in its environmental kind of study perspective. So as an environmental studies student, I'm just, these are the kind of like courses or learnings I'm looking forward to now. And to see that it's coming is very hopeful for the students to come to CMU. So I think it's a great opportunity for the future of CMU to kind of pull students looking for that and kind of looking at a smaller university as well.
And how about for you guys, Heather and Quinn?
I'll let you go, Quinn, if you like.
Sure. Yeah, I think the land-based learning proposal, building off of what both of you guys said, Jamie and Daniel, is hope for sustainability. It's been in the works. It's CMU Farm's been around for around 10 years or so now, and this kind of next 5-year term is what they're kind of building towards, and I think just going over the proposal and some of Heather's permaculture design is exciting to think about. Well, you know, this is what we've been able to do with the land we have right now, and what can we do with, you know, a bit more land, a bit more kind of services and tools and that sort of thing, you know, even tapping into possibly a greenhouse, hopefully down the road, which would ultimately pay dividends and extend our growing season where in a climate that really we can't grow for realistically that long. So it's just lots of hope is pretty much the one bullet point that I come back to and I circled back around to.
I think for me, what could excite me is seeing a plan like this do a few things. One, meet the university's needs in a number of ways. One being, I know there are drainage issues on site in terms of water. So how can the plan meet the university's needs in that way, for example? If there's conversation around energy, what can we do in terms of the university, the types of energy that the university uses? I think there's opportunity for great creativity, if there's room for that. And also for the faculties to start having conversations with each other. There's great opportunity for synergy, to ground learning in situ, on site, is really exciting. I think particularly of my area of study at CMU, which was international development studies. How great would it be to have a playground, in a sense, to practice in, like a place where you can practice the tools you're learning by textbook before you launch out into whatever area that is, whether domestically or overseas. Finally, I think what excites me probably most of all is the opportunity for implementation of the plan to be a model for resilience in Manitoba. If it's true that our climate is warming over time, that in 30 years we will be like Texas, then it's probably not too early to start thinking about how to anticipate that. So we don't just plant trees. We shape our land so that we can harvest and hold water and manage water, so that we can prevent the floods, prevent the extremes, right? Moderate and temper the extremes. So we don't have to deal with floods in spring and then drought in the height of summer. We can moderate all of that, manage it just by having a bit of foresight, shaping our land to accommodate that, and then implementing our plantings build our resilience, our capacity to be resilient in anticipation for what is possibly to come, right?
Yeah. Well, you mentioned that it would be great for IDS students to have this hands-on stuff. But one of the things that I think would also be great is for science students. I think there's all sorts of different, especially with the idea that Quinn mentioned of potentially having a greenhouse in the future. There's all sorts of interesting avenues to that I think lots of students would benefit from. And that being said, I don't think that this is a super widely known kind of idea around CMU, that I don't think there's a huge amount of people that know that this has been brought forward. Why do you guys think that is?
That's a good question, Dan. I mean, for me, I don't think I have a good answer because I've been so involved for the last 2 years. So I don't know if maybe like Chloe, she hasn't heard of it. And I'm not sure why that reason would be. Maybe there's just not much advertising going on. I don't know if maybe it needs to be posted more in their the CMU little daily part that goes out every other day, but I don't know, I guess. Oh,
so what you're saying is you need to get more comm students involved.
Yeah, if there's an avenue here for communications now, see like this project has so many different, yeah, just a lot of this, right? So yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, a lot of this between students and faculties.
And I think that's super cool. Like, this is something that I've heard Dan talk about. This is a class that Dan has been super passionate about, which I always love. I love learning about classes that I'm not currently taking because I feel like I'm still gaining knowledge from a class that I'm not in, but still learning from. And in that sense, Heather, I have a question for you. I know that these three guys here have learned so much from you, but from your experience, how much have you learned from your students or like the students that you've been working with? Like, what has that brought you in terms of this project?
I think so much, it's been so valuable. And I think probably the key takeaway for me is the importance of conversation. Well, for me, that's a double-edged sword because as I say, constant conversation going in circles drives me a bit crazy. Because it, you know, in these times we need to see meaningful action. But I think it was so important to be in to keep students in the loop, to work together as a team. And I think even beyond that classroom, I think even some of the points that you have mentioned, the larger conversation in the campus is so important with folks on campus, with the community, with the broader agricultural community, with politicians, with indigenous communities. Those are all very important conversations that I think necessarily will unfold. So I think that's probably the big takeaway for me in having the class involved was just the importance of working together and collaborating, because if it's a one person show, it's much less meaningful and has much less traction. So.
Lovely. Thank you, Heather. That's a very good answer.
Are there any other institutions that you know of, Heather, that are doing anything similar to this, either in Canada or worldwide?
Sure. Well, I know that there are a number of permaculture institutes across, like, globally, that are offering permaculture courses and so on. I also know that a number of universities have brought in land-based learning to a greater degree. I don't know much about that. Maybe some of the others would have more knowledge. I don't know if, Jamie, that was something that you encountered during the class, but I do know that permaculture is, there's some momentum growing behind that, behind permaculture, regenerative agriculture, other forms of regenerative land use methods out there and growing.
Yeah, sorry. A little bit that I found actually in the project was there's a few universities in the States that are kind of gnawing around a similar kind of farming and land-based learning. But as far as Canada goes, it's a lot of land-based learning from an Indigenous perspective, kind of gauging that and helping spread that knowledge and kind of giving back to that culture. So as far as Canada goes, that I know, I think we're kind of unique in that, in the farming kind of aspect and food security. But I think the Indigenous perspective is also very important and something that CMU is doing as well in this, that I look forward to kind of seeing how that goes. Yeah.
Yeah, it's definitely not something that's been overlooked. But do you think that maybe there's a bit of, like, how much does the fact that it's a Mennonite university play into the fact that it's that this land-based learning is coming out of CMU? Is there an effect? Because I might be, I don't know, Jamie, I don't know if you're Mennonite, but I might be the only person here that's not Mennonite.
I am very Mennonite. Heritage. And just the fact that CMU has a farm, like, attached to it is one of the most Mennonite things I've ever heard. So, like, a lot of this makes sense to me just from that standpoint, because I come from a farming community as well. So I see those sort of practices and I'm like, oh yeah, this feels like I'm at home.
Oh, you're muted there. What was, okay.
I said what I wanted to say.
Yeah, as far as I know with CMU, Dan, that I think there's a lot of foundations in land stewardship. So I don't think that the farm or this kind of program is too far off from what CMU is. Yeah, I don't know if Quinn or Heather have anything about that as well.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think it's, I mean, farming on campus, I don't think is crazy unique. I think it's gaining traction and it is evident in other, on other campuses. But, well, like, for instance, I'm pretty sure the University of Manitoba has some sort of farming and agriculture going on there because they have an agriculture faculty. But I definitely think it is kind of tying back to the Mennonite roots, as a lot of history, especially, you know, Russian Mennonites and Swiss Mennonites coming over to Canada and getting their start here by farming the land, and sort of, you know, reaping what they sow from the land and, you know, doing, learning from it, doing exactly that land-based learning. And it, you know, it may have not been what they wanted to do, when they came to Canada, or the States. You hear a lot of, you know, Pennsylvania Mennonites as well, but, you know, they may have had different jobs in mind that they would have liked to do, but in order to feed your family and to provide and to make sure that yourself and your family don't starve in a new country, you have to do what you have to do. And that was farming back then. So I know that's why my great grandfather began farming in Saskatchewan, and I'm sure there's a lot of others that are in the same boat.
I think in a lot of ways it makes sense that there's farming on campus. I think probably one of the conversations that needs to happen, where that could possibly be one of the more challenging conversations, or depending on how you look at it, one of the conversations with greatest opportunity, is between the kind of farming that happens on campus and conventional agriculture. Mennonite families have brought themselves out of poverty in Canada through agriculture, and since wartime through agriculture with chemical use and monoculture cropping. So, which I think I would expect the farm on campus, and certainly the design that I've proposed would, I don't know, push up against or ask questions about. And I think there's great opportunity there because, as I said, I think this implementation of the design offers us a chance to create a model for resilience that is scalable. And that, I think, is key in the conversation with conventional agriculture, who are our families as Mennonites, our grandparents, our parents, our uncles and aunts and so on, cousins. So a big, at least among the Mennonite farming community, a big family conversation ahead, I think, so, or potential for it.
Well, and that's one of the great things about CMU, isn't it? It's the community, the almost family feeling, isn't it? But yeah, I think that's actually part of how this could gain significantly more traction is I just don't think it was super, super well known up until the semester. And I think that it offers a lot of really positives for students in a whole bunch of different ways, also for faculty and for CMU as a whole. There's just a lot of positives. But I think that one of the things that CMU can do really well is have those conversations because of the way that the community is functions, is that it's easy, or maybe not easy, but it's doable to have those conversations in a relatively safe setting and get results out of it. Mm-hmm. And that's something I look forward to doing. And I think that there's a bunch of other people that are doing
things. We're like this. Already doing it. We're exactly, having a right? conversation. Look at us go.
Step one, have a good conversation.
There we go. See.
Yeah. And, go for and it, Dan, if yeah. I may, I think that it's, you know, everyone knows that there's a farmer on CMU, or at least, you know, they should know, because it's a small enough school, it's a small enough campus that just walking around, you can notice that there's, you know, some sort of fenced in area that's being farmed. So I think it's more so just, yeah, maybe, I mean, you can, like Chloe was saying, just kind of mesh it into the communications faculty there and give more people an understanding as to, it's not just, they're not just farming to farm, or, you know, because that's kind of where the Mennonite roots come from, but also there is a trajectory that CMU wants, or, you know, the land-based learning proposal wants to head in, and there's a direction that we're going, and that there is a purpose, there's a method, and ultimately raise more awareness to the ultimate goals and the, you know, the end game, essentially.
Yeah. Well, then, how about we hear a little final goal from everybody? What would 10 years time, what does CMU look like? What does that look like with land-based learning? What's going on? What kind of classes are being offered? How about Chloe? How about, since you don't know nothing about this, you get to go first. What from this conversation we've just had, what are some fantastical ideals that you have?
Oh, goodness. From what I've learned today and from what I've heard, the idea of having more collaboration between the communications program and these going-ons of CMU and these proposals and hopefully future implementations of all these great ideas. Yeah, I would love that collaboration. I think you could work together and create all sorts of projects and classes and all sorts of things that combine communications with a lot of other classes. Yeah.
For me, I just want to be not pent up in a classroom and learning. That's the end goal, I think. It was really great. One of the things we again talked about in one of our past episodes with David and Kenton is that part of our classes, like, we had classes outdoors in the courtyard, and that was incredible. And then we had to move to Zoom, and everything sucked, kind of. And it was really, really good to be learning outside. Like there's all sorts of things you can do by the nature of having a different kind of classroom, but also just the setting of learning. Just even if you're learning the same material, if you're learning it in a different setting, it's going to be impactful in so many different ways than if you're sitting watching somebody on the screen.
Jamie, what about you?
Yeah, I'd like to see more learning outside. So if that means a greenhouse, classes on the farm, you know, whatever it is with learning outside, I just want to see, I hope to see CMU really commit to doing this and not kind of falter in any way and just keep going. So that's what I hope to see. But a greenhouse would be major, I think, for me.
Nice. Heather, any goals?
Sure. I think three things come to mind. I think CMU being a model for resilience is big. I think there's so much opportunity for that. I would love to see CMU propagating its own trees, and even beyond what they need for just the campus. And I would love to attend a chorale concert in a food forest.
That sounds incredible.
There you go.
Can I add that to my list too?
Yeah, get music students involved with the whole thing too. It sounds great.
And Quinn, last but not least.
Yeah, I mean, the only reason I am taking I took participatory local development was because it was an elective for my degree. So I guess what I'm trying to say is CMU may be trying to implement something in your course requirements to have a certain amount of whether it be IDS or environmental studies kind of classes, or that can kind of, you know, if someday the CMU farm kind of makes its way into the sciences as well, then kind of trying to take a mixture of some of those, just so that every student kind of gets that kind of exposure to the land-based learning and the permaculture design that Heather's been involved in, and just to kind of brighten everyone's understanding and further the awareness throughout the campus. And exactly what you guys said about it's one thing to learn indoors and be lectured at by a professor, but it's a whole other thing to kind of take that learning where it's applicable and take it outside to a farm or a greenhouse and kind of getting your hands dirty. It's a completely different style of learning, and one that a lot of students would gain a lot more from than just writing down notes and being stuck inside daydreaming about being outside. So hopefully this is financially feasible. I'll add a little tidbit of business in there, but hopefully it's financially sane for everyone to do and to continue to do, and we can keep it going for more than just 5 years, more than 10, 20, and that we can just keep building and whether it needs to be built into CMU ultimately, whether Cheryl Pauls needs to devote more money towards it, or we need more funding, you know, who knows, but yeah.
I think that's a great note to end it on. Cheryl, if you're watching, talk to Quinn. Quinn'll start setting things up on the finances side.
Thank Anyways. You so much for joining us. I have learned a lot. I am especially grateful here.
Yeah.
Thank you guys.
Yeah. Thank you. And thank you, Heather, for joining us as well as part of our idea final project here.
Yeah, thank you so much, Heather.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah. Well, I think we're going to transition over to our next little segment, which is going to be Chloe and I talking about our quick wits. And you guys, you're welcome to stay, totally welcome to go. At this point, we're just going to basically be talking about basically little Wittenberg door segments that we've thought up and just kind of talking about.
Yeah, but if either Quinn or Jamie need to go study for some upcoming exam or something, feel free, go for it.
Or Heather, if Heather has any upcoming exams as well.
Okay, thank you guys so much.
Yeah,
thanks guys.
Yeah, thanks a lot guys.
Yeah.
Bye.
Take care.
Oh. Dan, tell me about your quick wit.
Oh man, okay, so. My quick wit was kind of already touched on a little bit. Actually, a little bit, meaning a lot. So one of the things that CMU talks about a lot, and maybe I'm getting a blast of this because I'm in a practicum class this year, but is the value of a multidisciplinary kind of degree and looking at a whole bunch of different genres of study within getting a degree. And this is something that's been in my mind recently because of thinking about journalism and communications at different places like Red River, where you'll get a very streamlined approach to this one kind of avenue. And I would, as I think CMU does a really good job of providing this multidisciplinary approach potential, but I think that it's definitely open to more. I think there's more that can be done. And I think that we kind of discussed that today a bit, is that there's all sorts of cool, interesting, CMU profs are not shy to do interesting final projects. We know this. And I think there's all sorts of, if at the very least, there can be coordination to get really cool final things. Like you know,
I hear where you're coming from, and I think I can kind of build off of it. Like, as communication students, as every student, you need a certain amount of area courses to graduate, and that's probably been one of the most difficult things for me to complete. And that's not because like there aren't great area courses. I'm taking great area courses, but I think there's more opportunity for area courses in places that they haven't quite touched yet. I would love to see more area courses in like IDS, as you were talking about, or in all sorts of classes. Yeah, I think there's definitely more opportunities for it.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah. Well, I think that about wraps it up.
Love it.
Oh, yeah.
I need to quick wit.
Oh, sorry. I thought that was your quick wit. Yeah, you got a quick wit. Quick wit it up. Yeah.
Okay. Hold on. I need to get something for mine, and you need to keep the people busy.
Is it a prop? Okay. Sounds good. Okay. Hey, what's up, guys? Have you guys heard of the browser extension Honey? Because I haven't, and we're not sponsored, so I can't say that stuff. But basically, what I can hear calling for. I know what's happening. This is great. I guess one of the things I can talk about is that this coming semester, there's no in-person, again, pickups for books. I mean, you'll pick up the books, okay, but you can't go inside Common Word to books. And there's the prop.
Come here.
Love it.
Okay, sit down. No, but like, you gotta sit like a human. People need to see your face. There you go. Okay, this is Maple.
Hi, Maple.
And my quick wit is that dogs provide a huge amount of serotonin.
That's not controversial at all.
No, it's not controversial, but I can... okay. I have noticed that I am more mentally healthy when I'm around an animal, and I didn't grow up with a dog, so I mooch off my friend's dogs a lot. And here's the thing, CMU offers free, like, counseling and all that jazz, and I think that's great. We have a huge focus on mental health. I think we need more dogs on campus. I'm going to be honest. Like, occasionally we'll get to play with Charlie's pup when things are, like, safe to do so. But I think something could be arranged between all sorts of shelters or something where there are dogs available to be taken for walks.
Whoa, Maple, okay.
Dogs available to be taken for walks, or like dogs that can be like fostered. And I know there's like problems with like living situations and all that, but I would love more dogs on campus.
Yeah, could you have like the main floor of KFA be like a dog zone? Like that people could something like that.
You have so many like very lightly used lounges in KFA. I'm like, fill them with dogs.
That might be a little interesting, but I like the sentiment. I like it. I do like dogs.
So that is my quick wit. Dogs provide serotonin, and we should have more of them at CMU.
I mean, that might make me want to, you know, come and live at CMU. Charlie, if you're listening.
Another draw for on-campus living. There we go.
Exactly.
Look at admissions. Yep.
Actually, Charlie's not even, Mackenzie, if you're listening. There it is.
Mackenzie, everyone, call us up.
Yeah. Well, that about wraps it up for today.
I think we're good to go.
Yeah. Well, thank you again for tuning in. Like we said at the start of the program, keep your eyes out for next week because we have some interesting stuff up our sleeves, even though mine are short.
Christmas special.
Yeah. It's going to be nice and wholesome because you know us.
And then I believe we'll be going on a Christmas break.
Yeah. Probably starting up back when classes start up.
Sounds
the first
great.
The first Friday.
I'll see you there, Dan.
Oh, I'll see you there. I hope I'll see you there. Yeah. Hopefully nothing goes drastically wrong knock on wood.
What?
Sorry,
on
this
that,
is
on that real hopeful note. Thank you
Why
for
do we always...
WRTV. We'll see you next time. Have a happy holiday and stay safe.
Kisses.